Hey there, Res Life, I'm Pastor Dom, and you're watching a special Easter edition of The Know. Here's what you need to know for this week. If you haven't yet, you still have time to check in your little ones to our Next Gen Children's Ministry. There, they participate in youth worship and have age-level Bible teaching. But don't wait too long, our service will be starting soon. Each week, we have a lot of opportunities for people to have community outside of Sunday here at church. Everything from Bible studies, prayer groups, exercise classes, and youth group meet here throughout the week. To keep up to date on all these activities, we've created a one-stop place for information. Linktree is a service for you to get our church calendar, listen and watch our sermons, sign up for events, and be able to get information about everything going on here at Res Life. To access Linktree, you can either scan the QR code on the screen or scan the code at any of the giving stations here at church. If you're newer to our church and want to learn more about what we believe and who we are, we have an upcoming event for you. Discover Res Life is happening on Sunday, May 15th at 1:30. We provide lunch and childcare and give you an opportunity to ask Pastor Ross literally any question you have about Res Life. To make sure we have enough food, we do need you to sign up. You can access that sign up anytime on our link tree, or you can sign up at the Welcome Center after service. If you've already made Res Life your home church and are looking for ways to serve, we have a ministry workers training class coming up May 1st and the 8th during our 10:30 service. This two-week class is a prerequisite for anyone wanting to serve on our ministry teams. You can sign up at the Welcome Center after service. Our mom-to-mom sale is happening on Saturday, May 21st from 9 to 1. This community event is not only a great opportunity to sell your gently used kids stuff, but also to shop with a cause. The $1 entry fee and all proceeds will be going to Life Resources of Northern Michigan. If you'd like to be a seller, you can head over to our link tree and sign up today. We're so glad that you're celebrating Easter with us today. We want to let you know that being part of the Res Life family means that we reach up to God for our strength, reach in to live more like Christ, and reach out to serve our community. And remember that if you ever miss one of our Sunday morning worship times, you can always live stream and rewatch on our YouTube channel. We're excited to worship with you, so come grab a seat, stand to your feet as we declare Jesus is King.
All right, well, you heard the man. Let's stand to our feet and let's celebrate the risen King of Kings. Amen? Okay, that wasn't good enough. We are celebrating the risen King today. Father, we're so grateful that we get to celebrate all of heaven and rejoice that your Son, King Jesus, is sitting on the throne. We're so grateful that we have the power of resurrection in us.
All right, the only solid ground, and the nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken, we trust forever in your name, in the name of Jesus.
Sing it out!
We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever, Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious, you are the only King forever, Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Justice you will reign, and every knee will bow.
The Lord gives victory to his anointed. He answers him from his heavenly sanctuary with the victorious power of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Come on.
Sing it up.
We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. You are the only King forever, Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are
this song now 2 weeks, and my voice is failing after this third service, so I'm gonna need you to sing it extra loud with me. You ready?
Your name is power.
darkness over every enemy.
Come on.
Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus, oh, the mighty name. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets. was my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Sing it out, worthy. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
Goes on.
Worthy is your name.
just bow our heads real quick? Father, we are so thankful this morning that we just have the opportunity to be in this place together, to glorify Jesus, to give praise for the fact that you loved us so deeply that you sent your Son to give it all for us. God, we don't take that lightly today. Today we celebrate that. We do believe that the name of Jesus is worthy. We believe it because of what Jesus has done for us. We exist to give you glory, God, because you deserve it. Father, I pray this morning. I pray that today people will hear you speaking in a way that they never have before. God, I truly believe that every person here, for every person here, that you have been speaking for their entire life, that you've been talking to them about their value, about their purpose, about who they were created to be, about your deep, undying love for them. I believe you've been speaking that to every person in this place since the day that they were born. I pray that for some of us today is the day we hear you. That today is the day where we receive the truth about who we are and about whose we are because of Jesus. God, your word says that you love the world so much that you gave your only Son, that whoever believed in him, believed in Jesus, would have eternal life, but more than that, would have connection to the Father, would have restoration, would come back to the garden with him. And so God, today we do believe that you deserve the praise. And so we do praise you today, give you the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, let's give him praise one more time. Yeah. Woo! Why don't you say hi to somebody real quick as you're finding your seat? Because you might have to find your seat today. All right. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Okay, we did okay there.
Hey, first time.
First time.
This is the best service.
I think that is the best service response. Hey, so anyway, I'm going to teach you something that I grew up learning. When the pastor on stage would say, he is risen, the church has to respond with, he is risen indeed, like a confirmation. So can we do this?
Yeah.
Okay, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
You can do better than that. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Come on, right? Well, if you're new here and you have no idea who this guy is on stage that's making you shout stuff, actually, I want to introduce this real quick. I'm Ross, and this is my wife, Allison, and we're the pastors here at Res Life, and we are so excited that you are here to celebrate Jesus with us. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Yeah, and if this is your first time in our service, welcome to our family, right? This is a good church family to be part of, and if you're joining us online, we're so excited that you are joining us today. Let us know where you're watching from. If this is your first time in the seat in front of you, you'll find this blue connection card. It's also on our website. It's the small card in the seat. Grab it, fill it out, bring it out to Ross and I. We will be out in the foyer after service. We want to meet you. We want to connect with you, and our whole staff will be out there. Just to make connections with you, because that's super important today.
Yeah, you know, we really do feel like it's important to be part of a church family. In fact, here we say that church isn't a building you walk into, it's a
family you belong to.
It's a family you belong to. And so if you don't have a church family, come talk to us, and we'd love to help you connect into this church family, because God has great plans for his family. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
And I forgot this last service, too. What am I?
Storytellers.
I want to invite you next week to come back. We're going to start a new series called Storytellers, and we're going to talk about the four men who wrote the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four storytellers of Jesus' life, okay? Pastor Keith came up with this name, Four Men and a Baby, like Baby Jesus.
It was an option.
It was terrible. And so we came up with Storytellers, so we're going with Storytellers, because I think that's way better than Four Men and a Baby. Like, way to steal that from a movie or something. Anyway, we want to invite you to come back to that. Today our service is kind of more like a regular Sunday service, because if you're a visitor, we wanted you to get a taste of that and not just some big extravagant show. Though, give it up for the worship team.
Yeah.
And they're going to be back later. And they put tons of work into this, so we're excited about what God's going to do and what he's going to speak to you today. The last thing I want to do before we go to the message is I want to just pray over our tithes and offerings, because we're not going to do that at the end. So if you're a part of our church family here already, you know that we bring back to the Lord what he's asked us, the tithe. And also, if we want to give above and beyond, we give offerings. So if you're new here or visiting, don't feel obligated to give at all unless you feel like the Lord puts it on your heart, okay? So I'm going to pray that God uses this money that comes in, grows it exponentially, and helps change the world for his kingdom. Amen? All right, let's bow our heads and pray. Father, thank you so much for each and every person here. Thank you that that we can celebrate the fact that you loved us so much that you sent Jesus for us, that he went to the cross for us, defeated the grave, and rose again. God, because we live, because Jesus lives, God, we want to bring back to you and be obedient to you and bring our finances in the way that you ask us to, so that we can see more people come to know Jesus. I pray that as this money comes in, that you help it to grow exponentially, that it changes the landscape of Big Rapids and the communities around us, that people we know and love that we've been praying for will be impacted by your word and by your love because of the obedience of so many people here. God, I pray that those dollars that come in will be much more than dollars, that there will be your word going out to reach the nations. We love you. We thank you for this, Lord, and we just trust you as we give. In Jesus' name, amen. So there's a couple ways you can give. You can give online at rlcbr, I don't do this normally, .org/give. You can go to the bookstore and give, or you can give in the tithe towers that are in the back of the room, the giving stations. There's only one way you can't give, and that's the traditional way you grew up with since you were 3 years old, of passing a bucket through the row, because we don't do that. If a bucket or a hat goes down the row, do not put money in it, because that money will not go to the Lord. All right, I'll be right back. Here we go.
One word from your lips came the world, man made in your image, and you saw it was good. But alongside perfection, temptation, slithering and sneaking, patiently seeking always a way to divide. He brings death in his breath, holds man in his sight. Surely you will not die, he states. One little choice, only one little taste. The garden gives way to the grave. Humanity forsaken, leaving communion with the King. Faith is abandoned for feelings and passions polluted by sin. The garden is all but forgotten, consumption ruling the heart of man. Placed in the garden, but choosing the grave, man wanders the valley of shadows in search of a way back to grace. The Father, creator of all, holds the heart of mankind in his hand, calling us from death back to the garden again.
God of salvation, chase down my heart through all of my failure and pride. Wanna hear you created the light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Where you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you done. Every part designed in a work of art called love. If you gladly chose surrender, so will I can see your heart a billion different ways. Every precious one, a child you died to save. If you gave your life to love them, so alive. Like you would again 100 billion times. But what measure could amount to your desire? You're the one who never leaves the one behind.
Come on, how true is that song? He doesn't leave us behind, amen? Let's try this again. He is risen.
He is risen.
Yeah. It's good to be together, isn't it, in the house of the Lord? You know, look around real quick. See how full this room is? It doesn't even compare to last night. We had the single biggest service we've ever had on a Saturday night of Easter. I'm telling you. This doesn't even compare to yesterday. It was crazy, right? So anyway, but not that you're any less than. Just as important to the Lord. Anyway, so if you haven't been here, we're in the middle of a series, or I'm wrapping up a series today called Gardens to Garden, okay? Or Garden to Garden. And really the concept of this is that in the beginning, when God created heaven and earth, but then he created man and animals and trees and all that stuff, he created them in the garden. And when he created them and he saw them, he saw that it was good, right? But it wasn't good for very long, was it? Like it didn't, that didn't last. Because Satan is cunning, right? He's a manipulator. He's a liar. He's a cheater. He's a counterfeiter. And he convinces Adam and Eve that honestly they should follow their feelings instead of following the Father. And they fall away from the Lord. So the result of that was that they were no longer in the garden. Now, they were going to head to the grave. But we don't want to stay in the grave. How many want to go back to the garden? I want to go back to the garden, right? So if when we started out the series, if you haven't been here, that's okay. Or bummer for you, one or the other. And so when we started out the series, we started out with what God's very first command to mankind was. And a lot of people will think it's love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. But that's not actually God's first command to mankind. That came after sin. That was post-sinful world, right? So the very first command, God created man, and then he stood before them or sat before them. They were there, and he said, go and be fruitful. Now, when we're talking about that word fruitful, it's not talking about multiplying the earth with your children. That's the second command, and multiply, right? But fruitful, that word that is found there in the Bible is talking about the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. Okay? That's what that word is talking about. And so you saw in this video, you saw the statement, what would the world be like without sin? Do you remember that we watched those people's answers, their faces were on there? I loved it. What would your family be like without sin? And the answer that we got was quiet. That's it. Your family would be quiet. No, what was really actually cool about this was that people, without being led in that direction, their answers to what would the world be like without sin, they literally listed the fruits of the Spirit. They said it would be a world filled with love, with joy, with peace, and they listed almost all of the fruits of the Spirit. And so let's go back to the garden for a moment and think about this. If the garden was a place with no sin, when God commanded us to go and be fruitful, being fruitful would have been automatic. Because there would be no effort that was needed to be fruitful, because there would be no sin. It would just come out of you, right? But because of sin, now being fruitful takes effort. It takes us being focused to following the Spirit, to living a life connected to the Spirit, right? Okay, so let's just go to that moment again that I think is so important, if you weren't here to catch, is that the devil is a manipulator. He likes to take the words that God says or the instructions that God gives us and twist them into what he wants. So, for example, God says, go and be fruitful. What did the devil tempt Eve with? Fruit. And so naturally, she's led into a sinful situation because she hears go and be fruitful, and then she's presented with fruit. And so what he says is, no, you don't need to produce fruit. You need to be filled with this fruit. God's holding back from you. And he twists it into a lie. And so we're not supposed to be consumers. We're supposed to produce fruit. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a fruit. I didn't do that in any other service, but I was feeling it. Okay, so what's important? What's important to note? Okay, bring it back. I know you're excited about ham or turkey or whatever. We're having ribs, by the way. Ham. Nothing worse than a dry ham, just in case you got yours in your oven right now. Lots of gravy. Anyway, so if we look at what happens here, is Adam and Eve, they chose to follow their feelings over following the Father. Because it says that Eve saw that the fruit was desirable. But when we fast forward into the New Testament, when it talks about being a Christ follower, it says that as a Christ follower, we're supposed to crucify our passions and desires, which means get rid of them. And so we shouldn't be living according to our feelings. The devil will tell us that we should live and do the things that make us feel good. But how many know that sometimes the things that feel good aren't always things that God says are right? And so the devil likes to use our feelings and get us to be led by our feelings, but we have to be really careful that we don't follow just our feelings, that we're following the Father. Amen? Okay. And did you remember what God said would happen if they ate of the fruit? They would die. And dead means dead, right? Genesis 3:3 says this. Eve responds to the devil. He says, what's going to happen if you eat the fruit? She says, you must not eat the fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. And this means that God never intended for us to die. That we were, from the beginning, supposed to live immortally, eternally with him in the garden. Imagine how close they must have felt to the Father, right? Being able to walk with him every single day. Literally, because of sin, they traded the garden for the grave. Them sinning signed a contract for death. And that sounds bad, right? Yes, Ross, that sounds bad, right? That sounds bad. But that's not even the worst of it. I mean, death is one thing. But they lost relationship with the Father. Worse than death is that they had to go through life not having that closeness with the Father. In the garden, they got to walk with him all the time. They got to be close to him like a father. I mean, that was God's intention, was that they would be close to him in that way, as his family. And because they sinned, now they're outside of the garden. In fact, if you look at the scripture, you find that he really is like a father in the garden time. But once they go out, he becomes the king, almighty God, the creator, someone you should be afraid of. And we see that because now they have to bring sacrifices to these altars to stay in the favor of God. Now it's all about ritual. It's not about relationship. And so because of that, we see this flipping and flopping of throughout the whole Old Testament of people who are failing to bring sacrifices to God. And then the next king, he would do it and redeem them and back and forth. But it wasn't permanent. Say it wasn't permanent. Man, you had to sacrifice and sacrifice and sacrifice every year. But the next year, you were already adding up all your guilt to just have to go back and do it again. There's a great scripture about this, but before I get to it, the beautiful thing about all of this is that even though Adam and Eve exited the garden, God started a plan to get us back to the garden again, right? And that plan was? Jesus, right? Our bridge back into the garden with God
is Jesus. Okay. So I want to read a scripture for this. I'll be honest with you. Last night, I felt like I struggled through this scripture in the NIV version. And so I read it in the Message version, which I don't teach out of very often. And I just felt like it read a lot easier. And so today I want to read the first part in the Message version, and then we'll do the NIV to close it out. So if you're one of those people who doesn't love the Message version, I love you still. We will be okay. All right, so we're going to start in Hebrews 10, verse 1. This explains this whole process. It says, the old plan, everybody say old plan.
Old plan.
The old plan is the covenant that was made when Adam and Eve sinned. This covenant that now they had to do sacrifices and rituals to make God happy, to be in his favor, okay? The old plan was only a hint of the good things in the new plan. Everybody say new plan.
New plan.
Who is the new plan? Okay, we're doing good. All right. Since that old law plan, the rules and the rituals of the old plan, wasn't complete in itself, it couldn't complete those who followed it. No matter how many sacrifices were offered year after year, they never added up to a complete solution. If they had, the worshipers would have gone blissfully on their way, no longer dragged down by their sins. You guys following? The old plan was not complete. Listen to this. This is the problem with the old plan. But instead of removing awareness of sin, when those animal sacrifices were repeated over and over, they actually heightened the awareness and the guilt of sin. The plain fact is that bull and goat blood can't get rid of sin. And then it says, that is what's meant by this prophecy put in the mouth of Christ. So these are the words that Jesus said. You, talking about God, you don't want sacrifices and offerings year after year. You've prepared a body for me for a sacrifice. It's not fragrance and smoke from the altar that whet your appetite, God. So I said, I'm here to do it your way, oh God. The way it's described in your book, in the Word, okay, in the prophecies. When he said, you don't want sacrifices and offerings, he was referring to practices according to the old plan. Everybody say old plan. Okay. When he added, I'm here, when Jesus said, I'm here to do it your way, he set aside the first plan in order to enact the new plan. Everybody say new plan.
New plan.
God's way, by which we are made fit for God by the once and for all sacrifice of Jesus. Isn't that awesome? So setting aside the first plan means taking the rules and the rituals of the Old Testament, of the Old Covenant, and replacing them with the new plan, which is salvation through Jesus Christ alone, once and what? For all, right? So I want to read it now, read just the end, the next couple verses in the NIV. It says, and by that will, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. And then it says, day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. Verse 12, but when this priest, talking about Jesus, had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. And since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. Now listen to verse 14. If you only get one thing out of today, it's verse 14. You need to remember this, and I'll explain it. It says, for by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Let me read it again. For by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Okay, so it's clear that Jesus paid the price once and for all, right?
Yeah.
Right? That because of Jesus, the old plan, everybody say old plan,
old plan,
is done away with. And the new plan is here, right? And I know for some people this is hard to understand, because if you've been raised in a denominational style church where there's lots of rituals, and nothing against those churches, it's fine. My whole extended family's grown up in that kind of stuff, that kind of church. But if you're grown up in rituals, you get this idea that we have to do all of these things to be good enough for God. When in reality, the only thing you need is Jesus, right? That scripture, I want to go back to that scripture real quick. Verse 14, it says, for by one sacrifice he has made what?
perfect forever those who are being made holy. So Jesus, by one sacrifice, has made you
perfect.
Okay, we could do better than that. There's confusion in the other service. Not holy. He has made you perfect. Okay. So because of Jesus' sacrifice and what he did in defeating the grave and rising again, you have been made perfect. But you're still in the process of being made holy, right? See, so much religion has taught us that we have to get ourselves holy before we're perfect enough to be in God's presence. And that's not what the Word says. The Word says because Jesus shed his blood on the cross that God sees you through the blood of Jesus, so you are seen as perfect. He was the perfect lamb sacrifice, and so he has made you perfect, right? We're in kindergarten again. I'm just helping you out here. It was never expected that you would be holy immediately. And so if you have this idea that you have to be holy all the time to be able to be connected to the Father, that's a lie. And the devil would love to take God's words and use them to lead you away, just like he did in the garden with Eve. See, what Jesus did when he made you perfect, you had to be made perfect in order to be connected to God in a way where you could become holy, right? Jesus came to fulfill one last ritual, the last time, one last sacrifice, in order to introduce you to the Spirit, to the Holy Spirit. I like to say it this way, that God, and I said it kind of in the prayer earlier, I think, I don't know, maybe that was last service, but they blend together at sometimes, that God is, he's the author of your life, right? He's written out your story as a plan, and I feel like we need to understand that having the Holy Spirit in our life is, he's our tutor that helps us learn how to read what God wrote, right? He's our guide that helps us read the story that God has written for our lives, right? That's what that means when it says, for by one sacrifice he has made perfect you and I forever. Everybody say forever. Those that are being made holy, who are in the process, following the Spirit. This is actually really explained in the next verse, verse 15. So we stopped on 14. Let's read 15. It says, the Holy Spirit, who also testifies to us about this, it says, first he says, this is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. The Holy Spirit is the Lord as well, okay? I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. So it is the Holy Spirit that will guide us to follow his laws and all of those things. The old planned stuff will just happen because we're connected to the Holy Spirit, right? Then verse 17, then he adds, their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. And where these have been forgiven, sacrifice for sin is no longer necessary. Period. Now, I know that that most people come to the Easter service and they want to, like, they expect to hear, like, the stone was rolled away and he lives, okay? He is risen. Yeah, I gotcha. I caught you on that one. Yeah, that's true. You know, one of the hardest messages for a pastor to put together every year is Easter, because everybody knows the story, right? Jesus died on the cross, defeated the grave, and he rose again. He lives, and because he lives, we live, right? Okay, we know that. But why? More important than knowing the story is knowing the why behind the story. Why did he do it? Jesus died to connect us to the Holy Spirit. When Jesus ascended up into heaven, it wasn't like, all right, now you're on your own, figure it out. I showed you, here's a book, you know, like, here's the Bible. No. He left us with something that was going to be our guide. Someone who was going to be our guide. We were never alone. In the Old Testament, we saw God the Father, the Creator, speaking through the prophets to guide his people. In the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we see that Jesus is here to show that God really is God, that he really is the Messiah, and that there really is salvation. And then when Jesus goes, he leaves us with the Holy Spirit, who's not like some woo ghost or something like that. It's the Lord. It's the Lord leading us, helping us to read the story that he's written for us, right? I think it's interesting, over the last couple weeks, the whole New Testament, by the way, is all about living life by the Spirit, not by Jesus, by the way. We're to pray in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus, but we're supposed to live connected to God's Spirit. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in me, in us, right? We're supposed to live by the Spirit. And there's no question in this, okay? This is new to you. The first command from God was go and produce the fruit of the Spirit. Right before Jesus goes into heaven, he's with his disciples, and he tells them to wait for the Holy Spirit to come before they go and minister to people, right? Later, Paul explains to the Ephesians people, the people of Ephesus, that when we make Jesus Lord of our lives, I mentioned this last week, that we are marked with the Holy Spirit. What that means is that when you make Jesus Lord of your life, you are like literally spiritually branded with the name of God. You are officially adopted into his family, and the name isn't something that's hidden on your driver's license. It's branded on you by the Holy Spirit. You are his. Yeah, sealed. You are sealed with the Holy Spirit. Like the seal of a king who puts his ring into it and marks it and closes that envelope permanently. Not to be opened by anybody but a king, right? And here we read in that verse 15 and 16, that it's the Spirit that's the one who's going to help us become holy. That we're good enough because of Jesus, and we're in the process with the Holy Spirit. So why is this all important? Why does this matter on Easter Sunday, right? Well, I think it's important for us to understand who the Father is and why he would go through these kind of lengths for us. See, he's a Father who loves you from the beginning so deeply. He created you. He held you in his hands before your mother held you in her hands. And he has hopes and he has dreams and he has vision for your life. And he wants to see you live out that life that he wrote for you. And he knows the only way to do it is if you're in connection with his Spirit, if you're in connection with him. And so he goes through great lengths. He goes through everything. He gives everything so that you can be reconnected with him, come back to the garden. Okay, I want to do something real quick. If you would just, we're not going to pray yet, just if everybody here would close your eyes. I want to kind of walk you through an exercise in imagination. So I'm going to tell you what I want you to kind of work yourself through here. And as we do this, I just want you to put yourself in this situation, okay? So just imagine, everybody's in a different walk of life here, different situation, but just imagine for a moment that you're a parent and that this day is the day that you have your child and you're holding your little baby boy or girl in your hands and you're looking down at them and you're looking at their little face and you're thinking, I wonder if they're going to grow up and look like me. I wonder if they're going to have my terrible sense of humor. I wonder what they're going to do with their life. And you start dreaming all of the things that they could be, all of the things you hope they'll be. You start imagining them growing up and them getting married or whatever they do and having a job. And you imagine life later as you're living and maybe grandkids. All these things are running through your mind, this future for this child. But things don't always go the way that we plan. And so just imagine that as a teenager, your child gets caught up with some of the wrong people and gets into a lot of trouble and starts kind of going astray. Kids that you don't necessarily want them to be connected to. Even though they're doing that, does that change your love for them? As they grow and they graduate high school, you're really at odds with them. And they decide they're going to pack up and move across the country, cut off relationship with you. Even though you might call every week trying to get a hold of them, they don't answer your phone calls. Does that change your love for them? The only connection that you do have is that you see them on social media, and so you see on there that they're making choices that really seem to be hurting them and hurting people around them. Does it change your love for them? And then you see, are you here? They've gotten in some big trouble. And then they've been arrested and they're in jail. And you try to call. And even
in jail, they won't answer your phone calls? Does it change your love for them? And then one day, your phone rings, and you pick up, and it's them. And they say, "Mom, Dad, can I come home? What would you give? What sacrifice would you make in order to bring them home?" You can open your eyes. You see, you are the child. You are the child. God the Father held you in his hands, and he looked at you, and he thought about your future, and he prepared a future for you. And he made you in his image. You are going to grow up to look like your father, heaven. And he's so excited about who you're going to be. But so many of us, we've got caught up with the wrong people. People who have taught us things and led us into situations that God the Father would not be happy with. But all the while, his love never changed for us. You might have run far away, and every time he calls, you just ignore it. You don't listen to the fact that he's calling for you, and he's searching for you, and you just ignore it. And all that time, his love never changes for you. He sees that sometimes you make decisions that hurt you and the people that are around you. And he knows that there's situations of your life that might have you feeling like you're in prison and that there's no way you'll ever get out. But you know what? If you'll pick up the phone and you'll say, "Father, I want to come home." He already gave everything so you could. Jesus did the work on the cross so that none of those things would keep you from the Father. His love for you, it's never changed. So come home today. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you so much that you are a God who loves us so deeply that no mountain, no valley, no raging river, no ocean can separate us from you. Thank you that you loved each one of us so deeply that you sent Jesus to pay the price, to carry our transgressions, our sins, our misgivings to the cross, to make us perfect. God, we all know that we are far from holy. We all know that. Thank you that Jesus has made us perfect so that we can go through the process of working on becoming holy as we follow you and follow your Holy Spirit. God, I pray that today some people are hearing your calling and they've been ignoring it, but today they hear it for the first time, fresh, new in their life. And they realize that where they really want to be is back in the garden, back with their Father, in a place where there's destiny, where there's security, where there's hope, where there's love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. God, I pray that today, many of us would be running back to you. In Jesus' name, and everybody says, amen.
All right, as we sing this song, I want you to feel free to join in. If you know the words, you can sing them along. If not, just don't be afraid to just let it wash over you. Let the Father's love through these words in this song just wash over you.
To make a rain.
So if you're here today and you feel like you're missing something, maybe you feel like the person I talked about, like you've run far from God, that He's been calling and you have refused to answer. Today I want to invite you to answer Him. Maybe today you feel like you've lived in that prison of guilt and shame because of your life or the things that you've done. Today you can break free of those chains. There's no condemnation in Jesus. There's freedom in Him. Maybe today you came searching for something and you knew it was Easter and you thought, well, maybe this is it. Well, I'm here to tell you that if that's you, today is your day, because this is it. There's nothing that will fulfill you more. There's nothing that will bring you more freedom. There is nothing that will bring you more fulfillment or peace than being connected to the Father. And Jesus did this for you. The word is very clear. God's word is very clear. It says if we will believe in our heart that Jesus rose from the dead, the thing we're celebrating today, and we believe in, or if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, and we believe in our heart that Jesus rose from the dead, that we will be saved. It starts with the belief. And then out of that belief comes this declaration that, God, I'm going to let you lead me. I'm going to read this story through the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to go where that story tells me to go. So today, here in this place, if you would like to make Jesus Lord of your life, if you'd like to start walking in God's direction, if you'd like to see what He has and how much greater it is than what you have or the world has, today you can do that. With everybody's eyes closed, if you want to make that decision, just lift your hand up. Is there anybody that knows they want to make Jesus Lord? Awesome. I see a bunch of hands. I'm going to wait a few more seconds here. If you feel God pulling on your heart, He's calling out to you, you can respond today, right now. Just lift your hand up high. Awesome. I see more hands. You can put your hands down. I saw your hand today, but that doesn't matter. What matters is that God sees your heart. And He knows why you raised your hand today. He knows exactly where you're at. And He's excited. In fact, all of heaven is rejoicing right now because you just simply raised your hand. And honestly, hell is in turmoil right now because you raised your hand. So we're going to say this prayer together. And in this prayer, you're going to declare that Jesus is Lord of your life. And from this moment on, you can start walking in God's direction. You don't have to walk alone ever again. You have been made perfect through Jesus forever. And you can start the process of being made holy with the Holy Spirit right by your side. So as a family, let's pray this prayer and invite and welcome everybody who raised their hand into the family of God. Say this with me. Say, Lord, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross, defeat the grave, and to rise again so that I could be saved, so I could go back to the garden, so I could answer your call, so I could break free of these chains. Thank you for freedom, God. Thank you for life, Jesus. Today I choose to make Jesus Lord of my life. I don't want to live my way anymore. I want to live your way. So lead me into the life you created for me. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Awesome. What a celebration is happening in heaven right now. A couple of things I want to say before the band closes us out is, one, be nice to people in the parking lot because I went long. Number, because they're probably already lined up. The second thing is, if you made that decision today, either a recommitment to the Lord or a first-time decision, there's a card in the seat in front of you. It says, Welcome to the Family on top. Fill out the bottom part. Take it to the bookstore. We have a gift for you. It's a kind of a process of how to start this new life with God. And I don't care if you live in the city or not, if you're visiting or not, we want to help you take those steps. If you turn that in, we can have the opportunity to connect with you and help you start walking in God's direction, okay? All right, I'll see you in the foyer.
All right, you ready to celebrate the resurrection of our King Jesus and those that have joined our family? Come on, let's stand to your feet. It's been a pleasure to worship with you. If you didn't catch the note at the beginning, you can catch the replay. But I hope you guys have a fantastic rest of your Easter Sunday.
Yeah. Happy Easter!
Happy Easter.
Hey there, Res Life. I'm Pastor Dom, and you're watching a special Easter edition of The Know. Here's what you need to know for this week. Each week, we have a lot of opportunities for people to have community outside of Sunday here at church. Everything from Bible studies, prayer groups, exercise classes, and youth group meet here throughout the week. To keep up to date on all these activities, we've created a one-stop place for information. Linktree is a service for you to get our church calendar, listen and watch our sermons, sign up for events, and be able to get information about everything going on here at Res Life. To access Linktree, you can either scan the QR code on the screen or scan the code at any of the giving stations here at church. If you're newer to our church and want to learn more about what we believe and who we are, we have an upcoming event for you. Discover Res Life is happening on Sunday, May 15th at 1:30. We provide lunch and childcare and give you an opportunity to ask Pastor Ross literally any question you have about Res Life. To make sure we have enough food, we do need you to sign up. You can access that sign up anytime on our link tree, or you can sign up at the Welcome Center after service. If you've already made Res Life your home church and are looking for ways to serve, we have a ministry workers training class coming up May 1st and the 8th during our 10:30 service. This two-week class is a prerequisite for anyone wanting to serve on our ministry teams. You can sign up at the Welcome Center after service. Our Mom to Mom sale is happening on Saturday, May 21st from 9 to 1. This community event is not only a great opportunity to sell your gently used kids stuff, but also to shop with a cause. The $1 entry fee and all proceeds will be going to Life Resources of Northern Michigan. If you'd like to be a seller, you can head over to our link tree and sign up today. We're so glad that you're celebrating Easter with us today. We want to let you know that being part of the Res Life family means that we reach up to God for our strength, reach in to live more like Christ, and reach out to serve our community. And remember, if you ever miss one of our Sunday morning worship times, you can always live stream and rewatch on our YouTube channel. We hope that you have a great week, because now you're in the know.